to see what God's got to do tonight. It's really an honour to be able to come up and think through some of the reading and experimenting I've done, trying to get ready for this evening. There's some really beautiful verses that we're going to look at. And they're really beautiful, and there's no way I can do justice. I'm going to skim the surface tonight and let God do the rest. Okay? So I trust that the Lord has plans to minister to us. Has it come up already? Not yet. Before we start, I just want to share something with you. I was feeling a bit wobbly earlier, and I was praying, and I wasn't getting very far. So one of the things that I do to speak with God is go to bed. It's my safe place with the Lord. So I went to bed, and I thought, he can deal with whatever's got to go on in my brain while I'm having a little sleep. And when I woke up, I picked up my Jesus Calling, my daily devotional. I'm just going to read it to you. It's not in the script, but I'm going to read it anyway. So July the 2nd, it says, "Let me show you my way for this day. I guide you continually so you can relax and enjoy my presence in the present. Living well is both a discipline and an art. Concentrate on staying close to me, the divine artist. Discipline your thoughts to trust me as I work my way in your life. Pray about everything, then leave the outcome up to me. Do not fear, I will, for through it I will accomplish what is best for you. Take a deep breath and dive into the depths of absolute trust in me. Underneath are the everlasting arms. Thank you, Lord. I'm ready to go now." I'm going to pray, okay? Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for this time to gather together, to worship you, to seek your face, and to rest in your embrace. Lord, we seek to hear more of you, to be more like you, and to seek your will in our lives. Would you empty us of all distractions, busyness, and thoughts for this short time this evening that we might hear you? Fill us afresh. Fill us to overflowing and reveal more of your treasures planted in the word that you have placed within our hearts tonight. We pray, Holy Spirit, come. You're very welcome here. You're welcome to come and have your way in us. Let the words of my mouth honour your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
So Philippians 2, 1 to 11 is what we're doing this evening. I'm going to set the scene before we get going. Paul's in prison. He's in Rome. Excuse me. And he's writing to the believers. He wants to encourage them and unify them. Philippi, who he's writing to, is a place of great prosperity. They were historically rich from silver gold mines, and they were a really good place to be for trade routes in Europe with Asia the other side, and they were the important place. The letter of the Philippians is also known as the letter of the Epistle of Excellent Things. I rather liked that. And the verses are sometimes thought to be a poem or a hymn. I'm not going to sing, don't worry. And they contain possibly one of the earliest creeds of the Christian church, which is Jesus Christ is Lord. So we're going to focus on chapter 2, 1 to 11, which highlight the selfless humility of Jesus, his model of obedience, and character as an example for all the believers. That's you and me, folks. Okay, so Philippians 2, 1 to 11. Yes. If there is any encouragement in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any compassion and mercy, then fulfill my joy and be like-minded, having the same love, being in unity with one mind. Let nothing be done out of strife or conceit, but in humility, let each esteem the other better than himself. Let each of you look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Let this mind be in you all, which was also in in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he emptied himself, taking upon himself the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in the form of man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalted him and gave him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I've got such a dry mouth. Excuse me, a cameraman's prepared me. So as I was reading those lovely words, the thing that struck me most as I started was the word if. It's repeated four times in the first verse. If there is any encouragement in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, and if any compassion and mercy. It's quite a thought-provoking word, if. So, what do you do when your thoughts are provoked? You go to Google and ask for advice. So I went to Google and said, please can you help me? I learned that from my sons, by the way. They are very, very good with Google. So if is a conditional clause. Oh, no, I have to press this. Yes. Okay. So introducing a conditional clause, that's what if is. On condition that, provided that, providing that, presuming that, supposing that, assuming that, on the assumption that, allowing that, etc., 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 it leads to something. It's a small word, but it leads us to something. To think very carefully about the statements that follow it. If there is encouragement in Christ, if there is a comfort of love, lots of ifs. So we know the word if introduces a conditional clause, I learned that, because Google already told us that. What Paul is saying to the Philippians is, if these things are true, then what follows is also true. And what follows is, press this again, then fulfill my joy and be like-minded, having the same love, being in unity with one mind. Let nothing be done out of strife or conceit, but in humility, let each esteem the other better than themselves. Let each of you look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. If we live our lives with Jesus Christ in mind, if we rely on God for comfort and hope in this life, if we enjoy and are blessed by the presence of the Holy Spirit, and if our character is motivated by God and his ways, then we will be people who are humble and people with a commitment to serve each other. So, Philippians 2 leads us with the challenge that if we are believers in Jesus Christ, then we will reflect certain characteristics and qualities of Jesus Christ in our lives. And Paul emphasizes humility and service. So, are we people of humility and service? What do they mean? What do they really mean? Let's consider a servant heart. Serving is at the heart of a Christian life. In John 13, it says, love one another. Matthew 20, the last shall be first, and the first will be last. And in Philippians itself, it says, look to the interests of others. A servant heart, as it was with Jesus, it is with us. It's a choice. We choose that way. He emptied himself, taking on the form of a servant. God decided to come to earth in the form of a man servant named Jesus. He emptied himself, pouring out all of his Godhood in order to be with us, you and me. I find that quite overwhelming. It's an amazing thing to think about. It's a bit of a mystery to me why he would do that, but I'm very thankful he did. God reversed the cultural norms. Oh, I haven't done anything, that's good. He came as a servant king. He came and he ate with the unclean and the marginalised. He washed the feet of his friends. He came to love us and serve us. He chose to do that, to show us God's way. So choosing cost him dearly, cost him death on a cross. It'll cost us too. But service is not for our benefit, it's for the benefit of others. Little examples. Abraham, he gave up his home and his land, and he went where God led him. Moses gave up his quiet life of shepherding and had to lead the nation of Israel. I'm sure that's quite a difficult thing to do. James the Apostle gave his life. Jesus made himself available to die on that cross for us. So, service is a characteristic of Jesus that we're being led to think about tonight. The other is humility. What does actually mean to be humble? How do we describe a humble heart? Now I'm going to press my button. I'm going to share some of the examples that made me chuckle when I was doing some research here. Here we go. Humility is like underwear, essential but indecent if it shows. I would love to be humble, but what if no one notices? If I say I am a humble person, then am I? And humility is one of those elusive character qualities that the moment you think you've achieved it, you run the risk of losing it altogether. Even the disciples struggled with it. Jesus learned that they'd been arguing about who was the greatest, and he responded, "If anyone desires to be first, he should be last of all and servant of all." So I googled it again, just to make sure I was thinking along the right lines, and it says, humble, having and showing a modest or low self-estimate of one's importance, of low social, administrative, or political rank. Sort of meant what I thought it meant. And then I thought, oh dear, I better look at the Greek, which is actually quite different. I'm not a scholar. I don't speak any other languages, particularly not Greek. And I've never had to work through translations before and find out what the words meant. So it's been interesting. Mm-hmm. It is a completely different meaning, but what I really liked was it looks so cool. I've just got to show you what it looks like in Greek. It's fantastic. It just blew my mind. Anyway, I'm not going to read that because I'm talking. Okay, the Greek word for humble is, I'm going to try and pronounce this, is tapenio. I think that's why it's probably wrong, but anyway, it literally means to level a mountain or a hill. To level a mountain or a hill is what it means to be humble. Blew my mind. So, people who are humble are those who have no hills or mountains in the way. Could those mountains be pride or ego? Humility is Jesus taking the form of a servant and willingly submitting to death on the cross for our sakes. If we can grasp a fraction of his humility, a smidgen of his character, or one little iota of his servant heart, we will become disciples in training. To see others higher than ourselves, living in complete dependence on the Lord, is to grow in our identity in Christ. So some of the questions that came to my mind while I was exploring these issues were things like, do I look to the needs of others? How does a servant heart respond on a daily basis? Are there mountains and hills between me and my Lord, and between me and those around me? How can I daily seek to put others' needs before my own, to love my neighbour, when my life is really busy and quite demanding? Do I think about these things very often? Those are the questions I was working through. But today I